It's okay, Warren, I'm not gonna kill you, that's fine.
Thanks.
Okay, lie on the floor.
Front or back?
I don't mind. Face up, that's right. Imagine now I've got a large sword, all right? And I've got it across Warren's throat. And I've got my foot on him like this, okay? And I say, Warren, I forgive you, I'm not gonna kill you. Which communicates mercy more? The first, it's all right, Warren, I'm not gonna kill you. Or sword to the throat, foot on the chest, Warren, I forgive you. I'm gonna be merciful towards you. Okay, you can stand up, thank you very much. You're very good lying on the floor. You see, for us to understand mercy, we have to recognize that there is an alternative. There is an alternative. God is sovereign. God had every right to destroy this people completely, to wipe them off the face of the earth. It would have been just and righteous for him to do that. And until the people understood the seriousness of what they had done, and that God could not tolerate sin and would not go with the sinful people, and now would not presence himself among them, until they understood that, they couldn't understand mercy.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website, you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts. Today's program is called Forgiveness, Exodus chapter 34, verses 1 to 35, by Pastor David Wise.
Well, we're looking this morning, as you can see from the screen, at Exodus chapter 34. We've been looking now at the book of Exodus actually since November 2007. We're not hugely far from the end. The last few chapters we will move through quite quickly. We probably only have got another three weeks to go before we finish this. Exodus is probably the most significant book in the Old Testament. It's foundational, as I say often, to everything that follows in the Old Testament. And as we're going to see this morning, the verses we're going to look at this morning and the stuff that is there is foundational, not just to the Old Testament, to the New Testament. It's stuff that we take for granted every day that happens here for the very first time. So this is hugely significant stuff. And if you've missed any of the sessions, any of the teaching, it's all there on our website. You can go and have a look and see all that is there. So, last week, who was here last week? Very shy people, so you know, just sort of like this, you know. So, what were the main things? We looked last week at chapter 33. What were the key things that we learnt last week? We took away from last week. What were the key things? Liz. Sin has consequences, yes. What else? What were the other key things from last week? Miss Lorraine? Okay. Sophie?
That we might ask God to show us his power, but he will show us his love and his mercy.
Yeah, we might want to see God's power, but actually what matters more is God's character. Ah, sorry. Lydia.
God wants to hear our prayers.
God wants to hear our prayers. Absolutely. We saw again the power of prayer last week. Anything else? Those were the three main things that I've got down from last week. Okay, Timmy.
We have a responsibility to intercede.
We have a responsibility. Yes, we saw that. We saw that power of prayer, that power of standing in the gap, interceding for other people, and the way that God hears that and answers that. Okay, thank you very much. So we follow on this week, picks up straight on from last week. The Lord said to Moses, chisel out two stone tablets like the first ones, and I will write on them the words that were on the first tablets which you broke. Be ready in the morning, and then come up on Mount Sinai. Present yourself to me there on top of the mountain. No one is to come with you, or be seen anywhere on this mountain. Not even the flocks and herds may graze in front of the mountain. So Moses chiseled out two stone tablets like the first ones and went up to Mount Sinai early in the morning as the Lord had commanded him, and he carried the two stone tablets in his hands. You may recall that the last tablets, which had been written on by God, Moses, as he'd come down the mountain and found the people worshipping the golden calf, he'd taken the tablets and thrown them and smashed them. He was so angry. So here God is saying, let's do this again. New start. Another two stone tablets, I'm going to write on them. There are two things just to pull out from these verses before we get further into this today. God is taking the people of Israel back to where they messed up. God is open to fresh start with people. And this was serious. What these people did was probably the most serious thing they could have done, because they made an idol and worshipped it rather than worshipping the living God that had brought them out of Egypt. And yet, God is willing to give them a fresh start. You know, that's so encouraging for us, sometimes for us personally, but always for us when we're talking to people about Jesus. Because some people feel, I've messed up so much, there's no way that God would care about me. But that's not true. God here, we see, giving these people a second chance. The second thing that we see here, we're not going to go back into the teaching now, but it's there on the website, those 2 weeks when we looked at the 10 words or the 10 commandments. And we see God giving them again here, and it reminds us that these 10 words, these 10 commandments, and the teaching is there on the website if you want to go back to it, they are central, they are key things in communicating God's will. And God has not changed. The same God, yesterday, today, and forever. And those things that were so close to God's heart that he communicated in those 10 words or 10 commandments that were on those first 2 stone tablets, we're back to again. And it reminds us that these things are key things that tell us about God and about ourselves, and how our lives are to be lived. So if you weren't here when we were doing that teaching this week, go onto the website, look at those. The 10 words part 1 and the 10 words part 2. It's there, and really key, important material. Verse 5. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and stood there with him, and proclaimed his name, the Lord. And he passed in front of Moses, proclaiming, the Lord, the compassionate, the gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands, forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children and their children for the sin of the fathers to the third and the fourth generation. This here is the answer to Moses' request. When Moses, we looked at it last time, chapter 33 and verse 18 says, show me your glory. And the Lord says, I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, which is the Hebrew word Yahweh, in your presence. And here is the answer to that. This is what is happening here. God passes in front of Moses, and he proclaims his name. Remember that in the Old Testament understanding, the name reveals the essence of someone. Today, for us, a name is just, well, I happen to be called David. But in Old Testament times, the name told you something about the person, told you something about the essence of the person. It's why we see people in the Old Testament having their names changed. as their circumstances change, as they change, God renames them. We see that because the name expresses something of the essence of the person. So as they change, so their name gets changed. And here, God, if you remember, back early in Exodus, God revealed his name to Moses, and it's that word Yahweh, and we looked at it earlier on. So if you want to go back to, I think it's in Exodus chapter 3, go back and have a look at that and the teaching that is there and what the name means and what it stands for. So here, the Lord is the Lord, which is, whenever you see the Lord in capital letters in your Bible, it is that word Yahweh in the Hebrew, being translated the Lord. And here, God is revealing what his core being is like. Proclaims his name, the Lord, the Lord, the compassionate, gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands and forgiving wickedness, rebellion and sin. Yet, he does not leave the guilty unpunished. This is God in holy love. In our contemporary understanding of God, a lot of people have lost half of the picture of God. I got in my office an article written by a church leader. And in this article, he's arguing that evangelism is wrong. We shouldn't go out and tell people about Jesus. Why? Because we're implying that if people don't respond to the message, they will go to an eternity separated from God. And he says, that's not true. He says, God is a God of love, and his love will win out in the end. And at the end of the day, there will be nobody separated from God. He's wrong. The article is wrong. Completely wrong. It's building God in his own image. Because the reality is that, yes, God is a loving God. But a part of a loving God means that God treats sin seriously. If you, as a parent, ignored the things that your children did wrong and never punished them, would you be a loving parent? And so this is holy love. And so there is compassion and mercy and graciousness and slow to anger. But also, he will punish those who have not sought forgiveness. Both those things are true of God. And we need to hold those two things together. It is holy love. If what this church leader was writing was true, Jesus would never have to come and live in our world, never have to die on the cross to pay the price to make it possible for you and me to have relationship with God. I wonder sometimes where these people have got their brains. It's just nonsense. Sin is so serious that God sent his son into the world to die. That's how serious it is. And God sent Jesus because he loves us, but also he is a just God and punishes sin. Some find this expression here, to the third and fourth generation, a bit odd. That doesn't seem fair. Why should it be that if this generation sin, this next generation and the generation after should suffer as well? It's a true principle. I mean, you can see it on the big level in what happens in society. I mean, let's just take our own doorstep. I mean, you could pick stuff all over the world, but let's just think about Northern Ireland. How the sin of one generation and their hatred and their bigotry and their murder affect not just them, but the next generation, and the next generation, and the next generation. Is that true? See it there? And you could pick situations all over the world, many of you perhaps from your own countries and cultures. You see it in families. You see how sometimes the consequences of sin, maybe from one individual in a family, doesn't just mess up that person and their husband or wife and their children, but actually messes up their children's children. It goes through and affects generations. You see it there. And that's what's so dreadful about sin. Sometimes, you know, we've talked about this before, people sometimes have this idea, well, it doesn't matter because it only affects me. What complete and utter selfish, arrogant nonsense. As though somehow we are just, you know, in our own little corner and what we do doesn't affect anybody else. It's rubbish. And selfish rubbish at that. Because what we do affects other people. You know, when you sin, it doesn't just affect you. It affects the people around you. And it can affect lots of people. Sin is serious. Because sin disrupts God's purposes. It disrupts the goodness that God is at work in doing. Yes, God, in his mercy and graciousness, as we come and repent and ask for forgiveness, can forgive us. And yes, some of those effects of sin can sometimes be undone, but not always, and not completely, all the time. And there can be a legacy for generations. So sin is serious. So we have this God who is compassionate and gracious. I'm going to read this list again because it's fantastic, isn't it? Compassionate, gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithful. Why don't we read it together, actually? I think this is fantastic. So let's read this bit out together. You okay about that? We're going to do it anyway. Right, from halfway through verse 6. So this is what the Lord proclaimed. The Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands, forgiving wickedness, rebellion and sin, yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. Verse 8 and 9, Moses bowed to the ground and worshipped. O Lord, if I have found favor in your eyes, he said, then let the Lord go with us. Although this is a stiff-necked people, forgive our wickedness and our sin, and take us into your inheritance. These are hugely significant verses. These two verses here, or the words that are in them, mark a massive change that is still with us today. What Moses is asking for here are two things. Firstly, he's asking for forgiveness. And secondly, he's asking for God's presence to travel with them, a sinful people. One of the writers that I was reading this week, a guy called Freedom, writes this. For the first time in the Old Testament, divine forgiveness becomes a fundamental way of relating to sin. For the first time here, we find God's forgiveness becoming a fundamental way of relating to sin. But that's big. But the second big thing is this. Moses asked God to go with them because they were sinful. The people hadn't changed. They could tomorrow make another golden calf. Okay, they're still sinful people. You lot here in the room, those looking at this on the internet, you are sinful people. Amen? Some of the people at the back weren't too sure about that, so I'll just go and check. So you are sinful people, amen?
Amen.
We are sinful people. So how is it that a holy God, we talked last time about God's presence with his people. How is it, and that's what makes God's people unique, is God's presence with them. Do you remember we talked about that last time? One or two nods, that's slightly encouraging. It's what makes us unique, God's presence with us. But here, we find God being asked to travel with the people because they were sinful, and therefore they would be completely lost without God's presence. They needed, God needed to go with the people because they were sinful. So how is it this holy God goes with them? To quote Freedom again, he says, only because of such a God who chooses to dwell among the people and stands ready to forgive can a stiff-necked people move into a future worth talking about. It's an amazing thing. We're just so used to it. We forget how amazing it is. We worship a holy God. A God who is perfect, a God who cannot tolerate sin. And yet, we have inside us the Holy Spirit, that part of God that dwells in us. And yet, as we've just confessed, we are a sinful people. None of us here are perfect. We all make mistakes, and we all sometimes sin deliberately. Sometimes we get it wrong accidentally, sometimes we get it wrong deliberately. And yet God gives us his Holy Spirit. And as a people, a community here in West London that seek to follow God, sometimes we get it wrong as a community. And yet God chooses to dwell among us. Isn't that an amazing thing? What future would we have without him? Absolutely nothing. And the people of Israel here were a stiff-necked people. Stiff-necked, it's that phrase, if we weren't here the last couple of weeks, when you have an animal that you're leading with a rope on its neck, you know, an oxen or a horse, and you're pulling it over, and it's going the other way because it's stiff-necked. You pull the rope this way, it goes the other way. That's what the stiff-necked people is about. Just like human beings. God chooses to go with them. So here's a question for you. Just think about this for a moment. Suddenly here, it seems, God is willing to go with these people. And yet, not long ago, we've seen God saying, I won't travel with you because you are sinful. And my anger might burn out against you and I might destroy you. So why do you think, and you won't find the answer obviously just laying on the surface here, why do you think God previously said, I'm not going to travel with you because if I do, I might destroy you because you're a sinful people. And now God is saying, I am gracious and all the other things that we've read. I do punish sin, but I will travel with you. Why do you think that is? Sophie.
I think because of the relationship that Moses had with God and the fact that he interceded on behalf of the people to ask for their forgiveness.
Okay, so we've got the situation where Moses has stood in the gap. Moses has a good relationship with God and has said, will you come and be merciful to these people? Yeah, that's part of it. There's something else here as well, yeah.
Because he's loving and compassionate.
He's loving and compassionate. It's absolutely true, but there's still something else, yeah.
He's a righteous God. He's a holy God. He's the people are sinful and God and sin cannot go together.
Okay, he's righteous, holy. He can't tolerate sin, so...
He can't be with the people. That's why he said he would not...
So he can't be with them. Now he's saying, I will be with them. What's happening here?
He's interceded and has a relationship with with Moses, and he's just awesome.
You're running out of words, Bosse. That's absolutely fine. He is awesome. He is amazing. But why didn't he mention this before?
I'm not answering that one.
Aren't you? Okay, answer the last question. That's
the reason why he continued to go with them, he decided to go with them, it's because he's got plans for them. And
yeah, he's got plans for them and so on. But I'm interested in why maybe he didn't let on before he was up to this.
Is it because originally they were more arrogant than they were now that God said, I will not come, because they were really not repentant. But yeah. Now that God sees that this time, yes, they are sinful, but they are repentant, and God says, I will.
That is a part of it, yes, because previously they just thought it didn't matter. And God's making the point to them, it really does matter. But there is something else that is here that I just want to dig a little bit deeper. Fiona, I'll come back to you in a moment.
Hasn't he prepared a way for him to do it? He's made them build a tent, the Ark of the Covenant there, so he's set a place that can travel with them, which wasn't there before. So because Moses has followed everything that God asked him to do earlier, he's enabled a way for it to happen.
Well, he's in the process of doing that. The tabernacle's still not built.
He's got the tent ready with everything there.
Okay, yeah, we're going, yeah.
And I was going to say, he's given them, if God hadn't said it wasn't going to tolerate sin, he's given them a chance to sort of reflect and then repent so that they can see his abounding love later on.
Okay, so he's giving them a chance to repent so they can see his abounding love. There's somebody nearly bursting at the back here. Two hands in the air, very Brazilian at the back like this, waving at me.
I just want to share, I think it's the time that God show his mercy for the people and just change and say, look how, because you know, many people just judge the Old Testament, say it's not, you know, it's not about mercy. The New Testament is about mercy and everything. But you know, the Old Testament, here in Exodus, God show his mercy for this people.
Okay, now I know you're studying theology, so I'm gonna push you a bit hard on this, okay?
Oh,
is that all right? Yeah, that's because you have both hands up. How does mercy work? The question here, you see, what is it? What is this thing about mercy?
Ask Warren.
Oh, well, no, I'm asking you. Because what you're saying is absolutely right, but I just want to unpack it a bit more with you, and I can pick on you because I know you're studying. You've done more theology than Warren has done, so he's got a way to catch you up yet. How does mercy work? Well, what is this about mercy?
Because, you know, it's about forgiveness and about love and about, because mercy, the word mercy, it's many things together. It's not only, you know, God, it's a loving God and forgive everything, but it's about relationship, it's about, you know, choosing people, it's about many things together. But, you know, the proper word, if you want to know theological meaning, I can't give it to you because I can't remember. You know?
You're doing very well.
But I think it's many things together. When you think about mercy, because it's a very important word for us as a Christian, because mercy, it's everything from God.
Yeah.
It's like a present for him because he acts with us with mercy all the time, with forgiveness, with love, and giving us everything that we need with his mercy.
Okay, that's very good. I'm going to just take a visual aid now. Warren? That's what I've got an assistant for, so visual aid. It's okay, Warren, I'm not going to kill you, that's fine.
Thanks.
Okay, lie on the floor.
Front or back?
I don't mind. Face up, that's right. Imagine now I've got a large sword, all right? And I've got it across Warren's throat. And I've got my foot on him like this, okay? And I say, Warren, I forgive you, I'm not going to kill you. Which communicates mercy more? The first, it's all right, Warren, I'm not going to kill you. Or sword to the throat, foot on the chest, Warren, I forgive you, I'm going to be merciful towards you. Okay, you can stand up. Thank you very much. You're very good lying on the floor. You see, for us to understand mercy, we have to recognize that there is an alternative. There is an alternative. God is sovereign. God had every right to destroy this people completely, to wipe them off the face of the earth. It would have been just and righteous for him to do that. And until the people understood the seriousness of what they had done, and that God could not tolerate sin and would not go with the sinful people, and now would not presence himself among them, until they understood that, they couldn't understand mercy. You know, if I came along and said, Warren, okay, Warren, it doesn't matter, I'm not going to kill you, you know, it's fine. What does that communicate? Weakness, that it doesn't really matter. But actually, mercy is about the sparing of life. And we need to understand, again, this is about the seriousness of sin. Again, in our cultures, you know, people just don't see it as being serious. And these people didn't understand how serious it was at first. They thought, it's fine. But then they suddenly realize what they've done. And mercy, which is so much at the heart of God. But it's not until they see the alternative that they understand what mercy is about. It's not until you realize that you, no matter how long you've been a Christian, no matter how good your life is, what you deserve is an eternity separated from God. That's what you deserve. It's what I deserve. From the way that you and I have lived our lives. What we deserve is an eternity separated from God. That's what we deserve. That's our just deserts. That's our wages, it says in Romans. The wages of sin is death. Eternal separation from God. And it's not until we recognize that and remember that we understand the power of mercy. Because mercy is unearned, it's undeserved. It's not mercy if it's deserved or earned. Or, you know, I'm holding the sword to Warren's throat and we do a deal. That's not mercy. Mercy is unearned, unwarranted. It's just a gift of grace, graciousness, and compassion. And the people needed to understand that. They needed to understand the seriousness. This is a people being made here. This is the people of God being formed. That's what's going on in this book of Exodus. And so these lessons needed to be learnt and put into the people, into their culture, into their thinking. And that's the significance of what is taking place here. Just before we move on, is there anything else out of these first nine verses that we can learn about God, about his relationship with us, before we move into the next part of this chapter? Anything else you want to pull up out of these nine verses? So we'll leave mercy on one side. I think we've done that. But anything else out of here that we can pull up that speaks to us about God and his relationship with people like us?
It seems to me that Moses is catching something of the heart of God in that he is not willing to abandon the people either. He wants them.
Moses has caught something of the heart of God because he will not also abandon the people. He was given the option, wasn't he?
Yeah.
But he didn't take it. Okay. Anything else? Carol.
Once again, the Lord is emphasizing that, you know, I would suggest that the important things, what he considers important is his compassion and mercy. And that when they see that and realize that, that will be transforming in their lives. And it reminds me, and like from last week as well, where in the New Testament it says, you know, they will know you are my people by the love that you have for one another.
So how God is should transform the people, and they should then live like God, God's values, God's principles, and so on, and the way they treat other people. Yes, very good. Ismat, and then I'll be with you, Joseph. Yeah.
Yeah. I can see from the first verses when God told Moses to chisel out another two tablets, although he's God of fresh starting or new start, but he never compromised his righteousness.
Yes, very good. So fresh start, but it's back to the same point. There's no compromise here. No compromise. Yeah, Joseph.
We see here that God is saying he's compassionate, he's gracious, he's abounding in love and everything, but yet he also says that he punish sin. So that means that we can't take God for granted, so to say.
We cannot take God for granted, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Okay, let's move on into the next part of the chapter. Verse 10. The Lord said, I'm making a covenant with you before all the people. I will do wonders never before done in any nation in all the world. The people you live among will see how awesome is the work that I do, that I, the Lord, will do for you. Obey what I command you today. I will drive out before you the Amorites, Canaanites, Hittites, Perizzites, Hivites, Jebusites. Be careful not to make a treaty with those who live in the land where you are going, or they will be a snare among you. Break down their altars, smash their sacred stones, cut down their Asherah poles. Do not worship any other god, for the Lord, whose name is Jealous, is a jealous God. Be careful not to make a treaty with those who live in the land. For when they prostitute themselves to their gods and sacrifice to them, they would invite you and you will eat their sacrifices. And when you choose some of their sons and daughters, sorry, their daughters as wives for your sons, and don't prostitute themselves to their gods, they will lead your sons to do the same. Wonders never done before you. There's some debate about what actually that's referring to. Some say this is about the removal of the ites, you know, the Amorites, Canaanites, and all the other ites. But actually, I don't think that's true, because that really is no more spectacular than what God has already done in bringing the people out of Egypt. It's just more of the same. I mean, I don't mean to diminish it, that it's not a great thing, but this is more of that. So what is it that is so wonderful? Well, I think that this is a reference to the fact that God chooses to dwell among his people. A holy God chooses to live among a sinful people. I think that is the wonderful thing never before done in any nation in the world. Because that is what makes God's people distinct, that God dwells among them. It's what makes us distinct as his people, God dwelling among us. And he reveals another name here. In the Old Testament, there are many names of God. And people are often, quite popular, you know, quoting different names of gods in situations. This is one that you don't hear quoted very often. I mean, I'm not sure of any worship song that actually has got, you know, Emmanuel, God with us, Jealous, God among us. But it's a name of God on the same level as all those others. Maybe we should get Andy to commission a worship song about the jealous God. Jealousy is an emotion, which is very interesting because God is describing himself here as being jealous, which actually tells us that God cares deeply about his people. God is a God that doesn't change. That is true. What is not true is, as some have taught, God is a God that actually doesn't feel anything. Some people, some theologians have argued that because emotion changes, so if God is angry here, but not angry there, God has changed. And because God doesn't change, that's not possible, is a misunderstanding of the nature of God and the nature of change. God is always the same, but different circumstances create different responses in God to those circumstances. So God is a jealous God. That's always a part of God. But jealousy actually is about care for his people. You see, God, I'm just going to pick on you, Frank. Is that right?
Okay.
That's okay. See, God wants the very best for Frank. Absolutely best for Frank. And God knows that the very best for Frank's only going to happen when Frank lives his life totally towards God. If Frank decides to live towards God 90%, but 10% to live in some other direction, his life's going to fall short of all the great stuff that God has got planned for Frank. So God is jealous. God is jealous about that 10%. And God wants that 10% back. He wants 100%. And it's not selfishness. It's because God wants the best. In human beings, jealousy is selfish often. But God is never selfish. So jealousy in God is about something different. This is about God wanting the best. That's why God is jealous about his people. That's why God is jealous about Frank, and God is jealous about every one of you here as well. The laws that are listed out here, being recapped from the earlier chapters, and the ones listed here, all about worshipping God alone. The Asherah pole was a sacred fertility symbol. Sometimes it was a living tree. Sometimes it was a piece of dead wood. And it was a symbol that was used in worship. And so his people are told, you don't have those. You cut them down when you destroy the altars. The prostitute themselves actually is literal, because as a part of the Canaanite worship that went on at that time, people would give themselves for sex in the temple as a part of the worship. And so the prostitution there is literal, prostituting themselves for God. So these verses we've read so far, verse 10 through to 17, the principles that are there, in our context and culture today, how do those principles apply for us in the way that we live? How do we take that from then? What are the principles for us in the way that we live? We don't have Asherah poles, at least not that I've noticed, in West London that we can go and cut down. We don't have sacred prostitution in the temples in the area. But what are the principles that are there that apply to us in how we should be living in our context now? What do you think? Carol?
Well, I've heard that a lot of some Christians have the attitude that, you know, towards other religions, to say, well, you know, well, all roads lead to God. And that isn't what the Bible tells us.
No. Okay, so
I've heard Christians say it.
Yeah, so there's I suppose an intolerance, not intolerance of other people, because we want the best for all people, but actually we believe, because Jesus said that there is only one way to God, and that is through Jesus, which means that other routes end up in a different destination. Mm. So we shouldn't be shy about saying that, because it's what the Bible teaches, yes. Sophie?
Anything that competes for God in terms of God should be your first priority, and anything that competes for God's priority as number one is actually almost acting as a substitute.
Okay, so in our lives there should be nothing else that's in competition with God. Wholly, totally for God, yeah? Yeah? What else? Jane?
We should be seen to be different from the rest of the population because of what God has done for us. And similarly, we should speak out against things we think are wrong.
So we should be different from the rest of the population because of God among us and what God's done for us, and we should speak out. Are there any illustrations of that that's in your mind? I mean, there may not be, but there might be.
Not particularly, but things that are wrong in society that we feel, you know, need to be spoken about.
Yep, okay, so we're speaking out things that are wrong about. You see, I think this whole thing of treaties is, for me, quite important. They were told not to make treaties with the people. Treaties are about compromise. They're about compromising with other ways of living, other ways of relating to God with a small g. And they were told they're not to do that. They are to be distinct. And there is this temptation all the time for us to give in to the prevailing cultural values that are around, whatever those values are in our own culture. Because it's easier to go with the flow, isn't it? It's easier to just accept the stuff that everyone else accepts and say, oh, well, it's okay. But we need to be distinct. And we need to be saying no, as Jane was saying. Those things that are wrong, those things that are against what the Bible teaches, we need to stand against. We need to stand against them in our own lives and speak out against them in society around us. Even when that makes us unpopular. And sometimes we hesitate to do that as Christians. You know, Christians have just got this thing sometimes about being nice. Now, I know we are supposed to be loving and caring towards other people. All of that I agree with. But I think we overdo the niceness sometimes. You know, Jesus was not nice. I mean, if you think Jesus was nice, just have a look at some of the terms that he used to describe the religious leaders. You whitewashed tomb, you vipers, you person full of dead man's bones. He's describing the religious leaders of the day. If he was nice, I don't think they would have nailed him to a tree. But we've got this idea, you know, it's in some of our sort of Victorian hymns, this idea of gentle Jesus, meek and mild and nice and all of that sort of stuff. And I think that's a misunderstanding. And if we start trying to live our lives like that, that we need to be nice all the time, we lose our distinctiveness. We lose our edge because we actually are called to be different because we have a holy God living among us. And we need to be different and distinct in the way that we live. Verse 18. Celebrate the feast of unleavened bread. For 7 days eat bread made without yeast as I commanded you. Do this at the appointed time in the month of Abib, for in that month you came out of Egypt. The first offspring of every womb belongs to me, including all the firstborn males of your livestock, whether from herd or flock. Redeem the firstborn donkey with a lamb, but if you do not redeem it, break its neck. Redeem all your firstborn sons. No one is to appear before me empty-handed. 6 days you shall labor, but on the seventh day you will rest. Even during plowing season and harvest, you must rest. Celebrate the fruit of weeks with the first fruits of wheat harvest and the feast of ingathering at the turn of the year. 3 times a year all your men are to appear before the sovereign Lord, the God of Israel. I will drive out nations before you and enlarge your territory. And no one will covet your land when you go up 3 times each year to appear before the Lord your God. Do not offer the blood of a sacrifice to me along with anything containing yeast. Do not let any of the sacrifice and the Passover feast remain until morning. Bring the best of the first fruits of your soil to the house of the Lord your God. Do not cook a young goat in its mother's milk. Then the Lord said to Moses, write down all these words, for in accordance with these words, I've made a covenant with you and with Israel. Moses was there with the Lord 40 days and 40 nights. Does that sound familiar? Last time, they lost the plot when he did that. This time, God takes them around the circle again, 40 days, 40 nights, without eating bread or drinking water. And he wrote on the tablets the words of the covenant, the Ten Commandments. This is largely recapping laws that we've looked at previously, so I'm not going to unpack those this morning. I just want to make a couple of comments in passing. This thing about Sabbath comes up here again. 6 days you shall labor, and the seventh you shall rest. Even during the plowing season and harvest, you must rest. It's just, we talked about this when we looked at the Sabbath before. But this principle of rest, God has made us as people that need rest. 1 day in 7, rest. We explored all of that in some detail before. But even when it meant that people suffered economic loss. When I visit people sometimes, meet people these days, I find people increasingly working 7 days a week. And I say to them, but, you know, God says you should rest. Well, I can't afford to, Pastor. I think when we put God first and we honour God, What does it say in Matthew chapter 6? Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be given you as well. And for some of us, we need to take hold of that. We need to put God first. Just in passing, this reference to boiling a young goat mother's milk is probably referring to a Canaanite fertility rite, which is why they shouldn't do that. Let's look at these last six verses. When Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of the testimony in his hands, he was not aware that his face was radiant because he'd spoken with the Lord. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, his face was radiant and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them. So Aaron and all the leaders of the community came back to him and he spoke to them. Afterwards, all the Israelites came near him and he gave them all the commands the Lord had given him on Mount Sinai. And when Moses finished speaking to them, he put a veil over his face. But whenever he entered the Lord's presence to speak with him, he removed the veil until he came out. And when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanded, they saw that his face was radiant. And Moses would put the veil back over his face till he went in to speak with the Lord. Just incidentally, on the side here, that word radiant can also be translated horned. And when the Vulgate was translated, which was a Latin version of the Bible, this verse was translated that Moses was horned when he came out of God's presence, which is why when you look at medieval paintings of Moses, most of them show Moses with horns. Have you ever wondered why? Michelangelo and other medieval painters painted Moses with horns. It's because this verse was mistranslated in the Vulgate. So there you go, just in passing. The serious thing from this is that the implication of the word radiant here, it isn't just about glowing. It actually is about emitting light. This is not just about having a shiny face. This is actually glowing. This is giving off rays of light. That's what the word means. And this phenomena made it clear that Moses was speaking for God. Not only could they hear the word, they could see the evidence. As one writer put it, Moses was reflecting in his very being the glory of God. And that came from Moses spending time in God's presence. And spending time in God's presence, we don't have time left this morning to dig into this in detail. But spending time in God's presence should leave us changed. People should know that we are different because we spend time with God in his presence. This also is linked to that grace that we use sometimes, the blessing. May the Lord make his face shine upon you. The link back is back into this passage here. Our time has gone this morning, so we don't have time to go into that in detail. Let's think about what are the main things, the key things that we've learnt from this morning. What are the main things that we take away from this morning into this week? What are the key things? Quickly, because our time has virtually gone. Andy.
You shouldn't compromise between God's way and the way of the world.
No compromise between God's way and the way of the world.
Our God is compassionate and loving, still he punishes the unjust.
Our God is compassionate and loving, but he punishes the unjust.
God is full of mercy. God is full of mercy.
God is full of mercy. Amen. Oh, I like that.
A second chance.
Yeah, there's a second chance with God. If you mess it up, God will give you another chance. You come before him and repent. Okay, let's pray together, shall we? Let's stand together. Let me pray for you as we finish this morning. As always, I want to give you an opportunity, a few minutes. You might want to make some response to God yourself. So a few moments to do that, and then I'm going to pray for you. Father God, I thank you that you are a God of compassion, grace, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. And you are a God of forgiveness. Father God, thank you. Thank you that you choose to dwell among us, sinful people. Even though we let you down, even though we get it wrong, you choose to live in us and among us. Father God, thank you. I ask that you will help us this week, wherever we are, whatever we're doing, to allow you to dwell in us and to work through us. That as we spend time in your presence, people around us, in our families, in our work context, among our friends and neighbors, they will know we're different because we have been in the presence of the living God, our lives transformed. And help us to be distinct when we're in contexts and situations where there is a temptation to compromise. Help us to be true to your word, to be distinct in our Christian faith. So, Father, I ask your blessing to be upon us as we finish our meeting this afternoon. In Jesus' name, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.